history of iron making started in about 1500 BC. It was the Hittites of Mesopotamia who first started smelting iron, and they used a very similar process as we used. Before the Hittites were smelting iron, the only iron you would find that had been forged was found on the ground, and they would find it in the form of meteorites. In Egypt, in King Tut's tomb, they found an iron dagger that was found alongside a solid gold dagger, and it was believed that the iron dagger was valued just as highly as the solid gold dagger because iron was so rare. My name is Celeste Flores. I'm an instructor at the Crucible in blacksmithing, and I have a business doing ornamental ironwork called Clay and Steel. So when we embarked upon this project, we thought we would take bloomery iron and mix it with Baybridge steel and make a big fire pit. So we wanted to make a lot of iron, but we aren't the best smelters, to be honest with you. And so each smelt, we only got 10 to 20 pounds of iron. So we had to do it many, many times. We started out with about 100 pounds of Tennessee ball clay, about 150 pounds of EPK, and 150 pounds of sand. We mix it all together with water and peat moss and kind of knead it together and then create coils. So if any of you have done ceramics, coil building, it's the exact same process. We are going to make coils of clay. We smooth it all together and we start at 4 inches and get smaller and smaller till we get to the top, and it's about 1 inch thick at the top of the furnace. So before we can use that furnace, we have to drive out all the moisture out of the clay. And so we candle it for about 10 hours. We make a little small fire at the bottom to get most of the moisture out. And then before we fire it the first time, we slowly run that furnace. The sand is the iron ore. It is black sand. We go out, we find it, pick it up, and then bring it back, and we have to sort through it with a magnet so that we have the purest iron ore we can start with. The reason this is so labor intensive is there's a lot of preparation that goes into it. And so before we can start the smelt, we need to break up the charcoal. And we have lots and lots of volunteers who generously lent their time breaking up about 200 pounds of charcoal for every smelt that we did. And we're looking for a very specific size. I would say about 1 inch by 2 inch. It is, we call it like nugget size. And so the extra fine stuff would clog up the tweer, the blower, and the big stuff wouldn't combust all the way and it would get into the middle of the bloom and the bloom wouldn't be usable. We're ready to start the smelt. We turn on the blower. We start a fire in the bottom and get it very, very hot at the bottom because heat rises. We want it very hot to start at the bottom. So we put in a bunch of charcoal. Once it's hot enough, we're gonna start putting in charges of ore. So we put in equal charcoal, equal ore, a little bit of silica, which is our flux. And we have to run that about every 5 minutes. That's our goal. And we're gonna do this for 6 hours. So we have to watch the furnace very carefully because we really do need it to run so that that charge of charcoal burns down every 5 minutes. So every time we put a charge in, we note it on a notepad and we time it. If the furnace is running too hot, if it's combusting too much, we might pull back on that charcoal or we might pull back on the air. So we'll do small adjustments to try and hit that 5 minute mark. So in the side of the furnace, there is a hole. The hole goes at about a 20 degree angle, and that is the tweer. And we use forced air to get it really nice and hot. In our case, we're using a bouncy house blower. Historically, it was probably bellows of some sort, sometimes also wind. So we force air into the furnace, and we're really careful not to block that hole, not to block the tweer, because if the tweer is blocked, then the smelt's over. the silica is a flux, and the flux is very liquid. It helps us get rid of any impurities. Hopefully it helps us to get rid of anything that might potentially block the tweer. And so once the flux, well, the silica gets to a certain height, it's going to start blocking the tweer. So we have to tap the furnace and let that slag run out. It's really beautiful thing that happens. And in the furnace we use, Jeff has created a way to look inside so that we can see when that flux is high enough, and then we decide to tap the slag. So as we're running this furnace, occasionally particles of ore or pieces of charcoal or the slag will build up in front of the tweer, blocking the flow of air into the furnace. And the flow of air is vital. It needs to be very, very hot. So we need that tweer to be cleared. So we have to remove it from the furnace, and then we have to take a big stick of metal and we have to break it out. There was one smelt where our blower was getting colder and colder, and we just couldn't keep the furnace hot enough. And so no matter how many times we cleared out that tweer, it was too cold, and the bloom didn't work. So the next time we got a much larger bouncy house blower. So we put in 200 hours plus 6 at this point. And the furnace has been running, and it's time to break open the furnace, and what we're going to do, it's called birthing the bloom. So we're ready to birth the bloom. And we put in all this effort, and we have no idea at this point if it's worked at all. So sometimes we pull it out and we get this beautiful bloom and we squish it together. So nice. And sometimes you pull it out and you hit it and it just breaks to pieces. So it's very, very exciting. It's very tense, and it's the moment of truth. So at this point, we pull out the door, which is detachable, and it's attached to the side of the tweer. So we break it off from the side, and we pull out the bloom, we work that bloom. And then we have a wooden stump, and we really gently hit it with sledgehammers to start to compress it. So we want it to get it into kind of a workable form while it's nice and hot. And also, if it's gonna break apart, this is kind of where we want it to break apart, before the house gets all these pieces. So sometimes we pull it out and we get the most lovely piece of iron, and we squish it together and you get this block that feels really solid, that because it has enough flux, it's really nice and sticky, and you can hammer it out, fold it in on itself, and you get iron. And sometimes what you get is did not have enough flux, or maybe one time we had big pieces of charcoal that got in the way, and so when we broke it apart, the quality wasn't there, it just fell to pieces, and then you have little pieces of iron that are kind of useful, but nothing that you can really keep. And so we've just put all this time into it, and it's just to be recycled, really. It was a big community effort to make this happen. We called upon our community, our blacksmithing community, and a lot of people were interested in going through the process of making their own iron. So we all came together and we brought different things. Jeff Pringle, who I'm sure you'll see a lot in this video, was the most familiar with the metallurgy of it. He's done the most smelting of any of us. So it was really new to us. And so every process was an experiment, and every time we would learn something from it, revise the way we do it, and try again. We didn't get as much material as we would have hoped, but I don't think that was too much of a disappointment. It's a really hard thing to do, and our very last smelt was our biggest harvest, so we ended up with about 20 pounds of iron in one smelt, so we improved a lot over the process. It was so rewarding, actually, that we made the iron that we wanted to make. It was really nice to see that we had made that from the earth. And to be able to forge that and to be able to use it was, it's very, very rewarding. So the Crucible is a nonprofit organization specializing in teaching industrial arts. We have over 25 different departments teaching things like blacksmithing, welding, bronze casting, glass blowing, leatherworking, a whole mess of different things. Anyone can come through our doors.
Six out. Six out. Looking for 62.